friends, and as promised by us that we will be taking second session on the parts of the Limitation Act, and today's session will be having more emphasis on section 2, 3 and 4 of the Limitation Act. In the previous webinar, wherein Justice K.T. Sankaran took us to the introduction of the Limitation Act, but now we have started taking the sessions as well as on the Civil Procedure Code by Justice K.T. Sankaran. First is the brief introduction, and then we take the particular sections, because each section has its own values in terms of understanding of law. And therefore, those who have missed the previous webinars of Justice K.T. Sankaran's, where he has shared his knowledge on the Limitation Act as well as Civil Procedure Code, they can like, share, subscribe, and comment upon the webinar of on the YouTube channel of Beyond Law CLC as well as Justice K.T. Sankaran's YouTube channel. The entire webinars which we have done by Justice K.T. Sankaran as well as other speakers, they are already uploaded on the YouTube channel. Similarly, Justice K.T. Sankaran's webinars have also been uploaded on his YouTube channel, wherein he has taken different parts of sessions. And it gives us immense pleasure that the previous two webinars, wherein we took on the Limitation Act, the general introduction, as well as written statement, they are doing extremely well, which only shows the lucid manner in which Justice K.T. Sankaran explains his stance, which is well received not only by the students of law, lawyers, other professionals, coupled with the general counsels, judiciary, as well as the judges. And the way he takes us to the entire legal position, including the judgments, is a treat for the ears to be understood and to be kept and reminded within the mind. And we are just too blessed to have the knowledge shared by Justice K.T. Sankaran. No words can match the in-depthness, the participants who are watching us live on the YouTube, Facebook, and on this platform feel when they learn from Justice K.T. Sankaran. Without taking much time, we would request Justice K.T. Sankaran to take things forwards. Before that, we will just again repeat, and we will at the end also say, wear masks, maintain social distancing, and you can always go out once things become normal, but at this time, be at home and stay safe. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Vikas. And I once again thank you for providing me an opportunity like this to address the lawyers and students and others. And also I thank the viewers for giving me the support in the webinars. Today, we have to deal with the subject Limitation Act, and particularly sections 2, 3, and 4. Introduction we had last time. And section 2, we need not go in detail with all the clauses. There are clauses A to N, definition clauses. Because by just reading those clauses, one can clearly understand what it is. And therefore, only where I think that some explanation is required, I will try to explain it. Definitions say, in this act, unless the context otherwise requires. This is the definition. Unless the context otherwise requires. Then clause A, B, C, D, I am not reading, defendant, E, F, Eastman, foreign country, good faith, H, good faith. Because this expression finds a place in different sections. What is the meaning of this? Good faith is defined like this. Nothing shall be deemed to be done in good faith, which is not done with due care and attention. Nothing shall be deemed to be done in good faith, which is not done with due care and attention. It is in negative form. So and so is not good faith, is good faith. They do not say, the definition does not say that. On the other hand, it is said in the definition, it is not, the following is not good faith. In that manner it has been done. So nothing shall be deemed to be done in good faith, which is not done with due care. Last time I made a request to all of you to have with you a bare act of the Limitation Act, because when we explain things, it is necessary to know the exact definition or exact usage of the words in the statute. Next, I would try clause J, period of limitation. This is an expression which lawyers and judges use interchangeably. What is period of limitation and prescribed period? So we say the prescribed period under the Limitation Act is 3 years. It is wrong. It is the period of limitation. Suppose in the particular column in the schedule, the period of limitation is there. The time from which the period begins to run is also provided. So that second column, the period of limitation, it is that period of limitation which is defined. And prescribed period is also defined. But when we say, when we argue cases, when we talk in the legal sessions and all those things, we say the prescribed period in the Limitation Act is 3 years for this type of suit, which is wrong. Which expression is wrong? We are not expected to use those words interchangeably. It has got specific meaning. What does that mean? Period of limitation means the period of limitation prescribed for any suit, appeal, or application by the schedule. So, period of limitation is that period which is shown in the second column of the schedule as against that particular article. And what is prescribed period? Prescribed period means the period of limitation computed in accordance with the provisions of this Act. A computation of the period of limitation is required. For example, Section 12.1, which says that the day on which the cause of action arises shall be excluded. So if a promissory note is, a suit is to be filed based on a promissory note. 1-1-2018 is the date of promissory note. When we calculate and compute 3 years period, it will end on 1-1-2021. Why? Because that 1st January 2018 shall be excluded going by the what is defined, what is stated in Section 12.1, which says that the first day shall be excluded. In computing the period of limitation for any suit, appeal, or application, the day from which such period is to be reckoned shall be excluded. Likewise, I said last time that there are exclusions, exemptions, extension, and no time running, and no limitation at all, various things. And 4 to 24 of the Limitation Act deal with it. 4 to 24. So on the base of the computation under 4 to 24, you will get a particular period. That is the prescribed. Suppose 1-1-2018 is the date of promissory note. 1-1-2021 is the last date for filing it. Say if, for example, it is not promissory note, any other thing. Say, for example, an appeal. An appeal, the period of limitation to the High Court normally is 90 days. 90 days we compute. We get 90 days, 10th January 2021. Suppose the time required for obtaining copy of the judgment and decree is excluded. You will get not 10th January, sometimes you may get 25th January. So what is a prescribed period? Period of limitation is 90 days. What is a prescribed period? What do you get after computation? The notice under Section 80 shall be excluded. Or the time required for obtaining sanction or leave from any authority, that is to be excluded. Likewise, several things are to be excluded under the various provisions of the Limitation Act running from Sections 4 to 24. And taking into account all these things, the computation shall be made. And after computation, what you get is the prescribed period. The prescribed period means the period of limitation computed in accordance with the provisions of this Act. So hereafter, dear friends, what I propose to say is that we the lawyers and we the lawmen are not expected to use the expression period of limitation and prescribed period interchangeably. Next definition, clause L, suit. Suit does not include an appeal or an application. Because when you see the CPC, suit, expression suit is there. For example, order 22, death, marriage and insolvency of parties. When a plaintiff dies, when the defendant dies, that applies to the appellant and respondent. So the suit takes in the appeal also, because the various provisions tell that. But here in the Limitation Act, when an expression suit is made, it applies only to suits and not to appeals or applications. That is why this definition, suits, does not include an appeal or application. For example, Section 5 of the Limitation Act. Section 5, the expression is, any appeal or any application other than an application under any of the provisions of Order 21 of the Code of Civil Procedure, that extension of the period, contornation of delay applies, but not to suits and applications for execution, because it is excluded. So whenever an expression is used, suit, appeal, or application in the Limitation Act, it means only that. There are, as I said, there are three categories of cases coming under the Limitation Act: suits, appeals, and applications. And each one is quite different. And when an expression appeal is used, it applies to only to appeals. So please, that is a matter to be noted. Now, shall we go to Section 3? Section 3 is very important. We'll read Section 3.1. Without reading, any explanation, any lecture would not be sufficient. Subject to the provisions contained in Sections 4 to 24 inclusive. So this is subject to the provisions contained in Sections 4 to 24. Not all, whichever is applicable. Suppose Section 6 is applicable, or suppose Section 12 is applicable, then that. Whatever section in Section 4 to 24, which applies to the particular situation, it is subject to that. Subject to the provisions contained in Sections 4 to 24, every suit instituted, appeal preferred, and application made. See the wording. Suit instituted. Suit is always instituted. Appeal preferred and application made. After the prescribed period, shall be dismissed, although limitation has not been set up as a defense. Even if limitation is not set up as a defense, if the suit is clearly barred, the court is bound. Suit, appeal, or application, if it is barred by limitation, the court is bound to dismiss it. Even if the defendant does not appear before court, he remains ex parte. The suit, suppose the suit is filed, in respect of a cause of action which arose on 1-1-2015, the period of limitation is 3 years. So the suit is filed beyond 1-1-2018. It is clear from the date of plaint. It is clear from the averments in the plaint that the cause of action arose on 1-1-2015. Therefore, without the aid of any other evidence, without any argument, from the averments in the plaint themselves, it is clear that suit is barred. Then the defendant need not plead in such cases to say that the suit is barred by limitation. You have not raised that contention is not an answer. If the averments in the plaint show on the face of it that the suit is barred, it is the duty of the court to dismiss that suit, appeal, or application as the case may be, even though the defendant has not raised such a plea. There are circumstances where it is necessary for the defendant to plead and prove certain things. Limitation also applies to some extent in respect of that, which we will explain later. So we will stop here, and then we will see what are some of the decided cases, so that position will be clear. What is this? An obligation is cast upon the court by Section 3 to dismiss a suit, appeal, or application if it is barred by limitation. Though limitation is not pleaded in the written statement, the suit is liable to be dismissed if it is barred by limitation. AER 1970, Supreme Court 716. AER 1970, 70, Supreme Court 716. And subject to the provisions contained in 4 to 24, it does not mean that all the provisions of section 4 to 24 will be attracted in every case. Whichever is applicable, that is applicable. For example, as I pointed out, section 5 is not applicable to suits. So when we say 4 to 24, section 5 does not apply to suits. So whichever is applicable in the particular situation, that applies. And then Section 3 of the Limitation Act and Section 151 CPC. It is held that for invoking the inherent power of the court under Section 151, no period of limitation is involved and Section 3 of the Limitation Act is not attracted to such application. You may see LS Synthetics Limited case, which I cited last time for some other purpose. LS Synthetics Limited versus Fair Growth Financial Services Limited. AER 2005 Supreme Court 1209. Paragraph 33. And it is held that the provisions of the Limitation Act are not applicable to proceedings before bodies other than courts and to quasi-judicial tribunal and executive authority, etc. As for example, this is important for our purpose, section 150. As for example, there is no bar of limitation for initiation of a final decree proceedings in a suit for partition or to invoke the jurisdiction of the court under section 151 of the CPC or for correction of an accidental slip or omission in judgments, orders or decrees. That is section 152 CPC. The reason being that these powers can be exercised even suo motu by the court, and thus no question of any limitation arises. So we have to make a distinction. The court shall dismiss. There are certain cases where section 151 of the CPC may apply for which there is no period of limitation. For example, an application for passing a final decree in a suit for partition, no period of limitation is provided. After the preliminary decree is passed, final decree is only an invitation to the court. An invitation to the court is invited to pass a final decree in respect of a preliminary decree which is already passed. Then section 3 applies to courts. I said that is LS Synthetics case also 2004. I said AER 2005 Supreme Court 1209. Parallel citation is 2004 11 SEC 456. Then, if this is important, what I am going to say is important. I'll read a short paragraph, very short paragraph. When the question of limitation is purely one of law, capable of determination on the facts admitted or proved before court, the court is bound to raise the question sua moto and decide. But where the question of limitation raises issues of facts not arising from the plaint, the defendant is bound under Order 8 Rule 2 CPC to raise such question in his written statement. However, if the facts proved or admitted show that the suit or other proceeding does not seem to be barred, the court is not bound to raise the question of limitation because it is not bound to speculate upon possible questions of limitation. So this duty cast on the court that the court shall dismiss, even though limitation is not taken as a ground of defense, applies only to cases where the plaint discloses or the admitted or proved facts disclose that the suit is barred. Otherwise not. For example, when a contention is raised by the plaintiff, that though the date of the instrument or document or any other date on which the cause of action arises is a particular date, and though the period of limitation, namely 3 years, has expired, Still, the suit is not barred because there is an acknowledgement within the meaning of Section 18 before the date of expiry of the period of limitation. So that is a matter to be proved. Suppose the defendant says that acknowledgement is not valid. It is not said, signed by him. It is a fabricated one. That is a matter to be proved by the plaintiff in order to enable him to make the suit within the period of limitation. So sometimes certain facts are necessary to be proved. Certain facts have to be proved by the plaintiff to enable the benefit of exemption from limitation. For example, this payment, part payment. A suit is filed for 10 lakhs. It is on the face of it barred by limitation. But the plaintiff says, before the expiry of the period of limitation, a part of the amount has been paid by the defendant and it has been made, noted on the instrument document which evidences the transaction. Then if that is disputed, it is for the plaintiff to prove that. In such circumstances, it is a matter for proof. Or the plaintiff, the averments in the plaintiff does not, they do not disclose that the suit is barred. Something is to be proved in the case. Some contentions are to be raised by the defendant, in which case it is for the defendant to raise it and the court need not speculate on all those things. You may note 2005-6 SEC 614. 2005-6 SEC 614. Name of the case is Narne Ramamurthy. Narne Ramamurthy versus Raula Soma Sundaram. Paragraph 5. When limitation is pure question of law and from the pleadings itself it becomes apparent that the suit is barred by limitation, then of course it is a duty of the court to decide limitation at the outset, even in the absence of a plea. However, in cases where the question of limitation is a mixed question of fact and law, the suit does not appear to be barred by limitation on the face of it, then the facts necessary to prove limitation must be pleaded, an issue raised, and then proved. What are the other provisions in the CPC which are relevant while considering Section 3? Please note, plain, Order 7, Rule 6. I'll just go reading. Order 7, Rule 6. Order 7, Rule 11D. Then written statement, Order 8, Rule 2. Order 8, Rule 2. Set off, Order 8, Rule 6. Counterclaim, Order 8, Rule 6A to 6G. 6A to 6G. Presentation of appeal, Order 41, Rules 1 and 3. These provisions in the CPC are also connected with the various interpretations which may arise while considering Section 3. Now, let us see the other subsections of Section 3. For the purpose of this act, a suit is instituted in the ordinary case when the plaintiff is presented to the proper officer. No dispute over it. There is no complication over it. By just reading it, we can understand. In the case of a pauper, that is indigent person, Order 33 and Order 44. Order 33 for suits, Order 44 for appeals. In the case of a pauper, when the application for leave to sue as a pauper is made. In the case of a claim against a company which is being bound up by the court, then the claimant first sends in his claim to the official liquidator. So along with this, in the case of pauper, an explanation is required. In the case of pauper, please see also Section 13 of the Limitation Act. Section 13 says, exclusion of time in cases where leave to sue or appeal as a pauper is applied for. In computing the period of limitation prescribed for any suit, appeal, or a suit or appeal, in any case when its application for leave to sue or appeal as a pauper has been made and rejected, that application has been filed but rejected, the time during which the applicant has been prosecuting in good faith his application for such leave shall be excluded. And the court may on payment of the court fee prescribed for such suit or appeal, treat the suit or appeal as having the same force and effect as if the court fee has been paid in the first instance. So this period, an application has been made to allow the plaintiff to file the suit as a pauper, as an indigent person under Order 33. Notice was issued, parties were heard, and that application was dismissed on some ground. Either it is not, there is no disclosure of the assets by the plaintiff, or because he is not a pauper, or when it is proved by the government or by the defendant that he is having enough resources to pay the court fee, and therefore he does not satisfy the expression indigent person. In many cases, many, many circumstances may arise where the application for allowing the plaintiff to file the suit as a pauper may get rejected. In which case, suppose the suit last date for filing the suit is 1/1/2020. Just a few days before that, the suit was filed. It is well settled that no court will ask, why did you wait till this moment? Because it is the right of the party to wait till the last day of limitation. So before the expiry of the period of limitation, the suit was filed. The suit was, an application was filed under Order 33 CPC for leave to file the suit as an indigent person. That it took 6 months time to dispose of that application. And that application is rejected. Next day, he pays the court fee. Then on payment of the court fee, it relates back and the suit shall be deemed to have been filed on the date on which the application for suing as a pauper has been made before. So by relating this back, because if the suit is filed on the date on which the application is rejected, it is barred by time. If a fresh suit is filed, it is barred by time. Only when that application is dismissed, the court grants time or does not grant time. Immediately after rejection, the court fee is paid. It shall relate back to the date on which the application to file the suit as a pauper has been made. So that is a protection which is contained in Section 13 of the Limitation Act. Along with this, we have to see Rule 15, capital A of Order 33, CPC. Rule 15A of Order 33. What does it say? Grant of time for payment of court fee. Here 13 said, the time during which a person was prosecuting his application in good faith shall be excluded. Not beyond that. Not beyond that. Suppose the application is rejected on a particular date and immediately he pays the court fee, then it is all right. Then it will relate back to the date on which the application was filed. Suppose he pays the court fee after a period of 2 weeks, then there is no question of exclusion from that time. Suppose the suit is filed on the last day of limitation and an application is filed to sue as a pauper, that application is rejected, then he took 15 days or 30 days to pay the court fee. Court will not exclude that time unless Rule 15A of Order 33 applies. What is Rule 15A of Order 33? Nothing contained in Rules 5, 7 or 15 shall prevent a court while rejecting an application under Rule 5 or refusing an application under Rule 7, different circumstances, from granting time to the applicant to pay the requisite court fee within such time as may be fixed by the court or extended by it from time to time. And upon such payment and on payment of the costs referred to in Rule 15 within time, the suit shall be deemed to have been instituted on the date on which the application for permission to sue as an indigent person was presented. So this is an extension further of Section 13 of the Limitation Act. Section 3 says that in the case of a pauper, when his application for leave to as a pauper is made, that is the date for the purpose of this act, a suit is instituted. True. Then it took 6 months or 9 months to dispose of that application. And what about that period? By this deeming fiction, it relates back, but not always. Section 13, the application of Section 13 also should be there. when 13 is applied, the period during which he was prosecuting in good faith, it is not simply filing it. It must be filed in good faith. Then the court is satisfied that it was filed and prosecuted in good faith. The period during which that application was pending in court shall be excluded. Not further, not beyond that. Beyond that, Rule 15A of Order 33 CPC, where the court grants time or grants time and then further extends from time to time, and if that court fee is paid within time, then it will relate back to the date on which the application for filing the suit as a pauper has been made. So the position is very clear. All these provisions are relevant. Now, next, Clause B. Any claim by way of set-off or counterclaim shall be treated as a separate suit and shall be deemed to have been instituted. Here, it is tricky. Please see. Any claim by way of set-off or counterclaim shall be treated as a separate suit, that we know, and shall be deemed to have been instituted in the case of a set-off on the same date as the suit in which the set-off is pleaded. In the case of a counterclaim, on the date on which the counterclaim is made in court. What is the meaning of this? Meaning of this is, say, I am the defendant in the suit. You file the suit against me. I am the defendant. I am entitled to plead set-off. If I am entitled to plead set-off, I am also entitled to file a suit in respect of that set-off. Suppose there are series of transactions between us. We fill in the same character and the requirement of pleading a set-off are satisfied. Money claim. You file the suit for 10 lakhs. I am entitled to get 25,000 from you. There are series of transactions. I don't want to disturb the relation and file a suit for 25,000. But within the period of limitation, you file your suit for 10 lakhs. And by that time, by the time I received the summons and the suit, my period of limitation for filing the set-off is over. What shall I do? After receiving the summons, I file the set-off, it shall be deemed that the set-off has been made, the limitation will be computed with reference to the date on which the suit is filed. So if on the date of filing of the suit, my claim of set-off is not barred, it is not barred notwithstanding that return statement is filed 3 months or 4 months beyond the period of limitation. Only thing is that the return statement is filed within time as provided under law. And if it is filed, it shall be deemed that the set-off has been pleaded and that set-off will relate back to the date on which the suit is filed. So if on the date of filing of the suit, it is not barred, the set-off is not barred, a suit for claiming that amount under the set-off is not barred, then that set-off is not barred. But so far as a counterclaim is concerned, it is different. Counterclaim shall be deemed to have been filed on the date on which the counterclaim is made in court. So if a counterclaim is barred on the date of filing the written statement, then it is barred. Counterclaim can be in respect of a cause of action which has arisen even after filing the suit, but before the date fixed for filing, which we have seen under Order 8 Rule 6A. In the case of a counterclaim, on the date on which the counterclaim is made. An application by notice of motion, the High Court is made when the application is presented to the proper officer. So this is what is Section 3. Now, I would refer to some decided cases that court shall be bound to dismiss. This applies to the appellate court also. If a suit is filed, the defendant did not raise the plea of limitation, but on the face of the claim, the suit is barred. Going by Section 3.1, it is the duty of the court to dismiss the suit. But the suit was decreed. Then the defendant files an appeal. Though he was ex parte decree also, an appeal lies under Section 96 of CPC. So he files an appeal. he satisfies the appellate court that on the face of the claim, the suit is barred. So that duty which is cast on the trial court applies equally to the appellate court as well. If the question of limitation is capable of being decided on the admitted facts or proved facts, the respondent in the appeal is even entitled to contend before the appellate court that the suit was barred by limitation. Please see AER 1969 Supreme Court, 1969 Supreme Court, 1335. Name of the case is Town Municipal Council, Attani. Town Municipal Council, Attani versus Presiding Officer, Labour Court. So many points are decided under the Industrial Disputes Act, but this question also arises. Next is 2000, same point, 2016, Volume 14 SEC, 2016, Volume 14 SEC, 761. Name of the case is State of Gujarat versus Messrs. Kothari Associates. Failure of the trial court to consider the issue in such a case. A duty was cast on the court to consider that aspect of law even on its own initiative. And since it failed to do so, the appellant state was competent to raise the legal question in appeal or indeed even in any successive appeal. Even though the defendant did not appear, did not file a written statement, provided it is clear from the averments in the plaint and the admitted facts that the suit is barred by limitation. Now, suppose a decree is passed in a suit which is barred by limitation. Suit is clearly barred by limitation. I am the defendant in the suit. Anybody who looks at the plaint can see that the suit is barred by limitation. Nevertheless, the court decrees it. I did not appear before court. I believed that the court will do justice to me. Court is manned by learned persons. Therefore, I need not rush to the court and file the written statement and plead and all those things. I believed in court. I did not go to the court. I did not file a written statement. But on the averments in the plaint, it is clearly barred. And still, a decree is passed by the court. When it is put in execution, I raise a contention that the decree is a nullity because it is barred by limitation. The question which I am putting is whether such a contention can be raised. Before answering that question, it is a settled legal principle right from 1950s up to date that the invalidity of a decree can be set up whenever and wherever it is raised, even in execution or in collateral proceedings. Even in 2021 decision of the Supreme Court, this principle is well set. So that a decree is void. It was not contended that the court has no jurisdiction. No contention was raised. Defendant did not go to the court. Passed an ex parte decree. But still it is clear that the court which passed the decree has no jurisdiction. No jurisdiction over the subject matter. I am not saying about territorial or pecuniary jurisdiction, which can be waived. But jurisdiction over the subject matter. A suit is decreed against a minor who was not represented by a guardian, or an insane person who was not represented by a guardian. A suit was decreed against a dead man on the party array. All these are instances where the decree is a nullity. Its invalidity can be set up whenever and wherever it is raised and when it is executed, even in execution or in collateral proceedings. That is a well-settled principle. Now, let us see whether this decree which is passed in a suit which is barred by limitation, whether it is a nullity. Answer is no. The court has jurisdiction. True, Section 3 says that if it is clear from the plain on the admitted or proved facts that the suit is barred by limitation, it is a duty of the court to dismiss it. Nevertheless, it decreed it. Even then, the decree does not become null and void. See a citation, AER 1964 Supreme Court. AER 1964 Supreme Court 907. Four judges. Ittiyavara Mathai versus ITTYAVIRA. Ittiyavara Mathai versus Varki Varki. Then also, it is relied on by three judges in AER 2019 Supreme Court. 2019 Supreme Court 5125. Nosli Nevile Wadia. Nosli Nevile Wadia versus Ivory Properties. Then next 2005-6 SEC 614. Two judges. Narne Ramamurthy, which I have already cited today. Narne Ramamurthy versus Soma Sundaram. And it is also held in 2019 Supreme Court, which I cited. Limitation a mixed question of law and fact cannot be decided as a preliminary issue. That point is also decided. So that it can be made use of for you as lawyers. Now, set off and counterclaim, which I said, please also note. AER 1987 Supreme Court 1395. AER 1987 Supreme Court 1395. Supreme Court held that a counterclaim which is treated as a cross suit can be preferred before the time limited by the Limitation Act for filing the suit on the same cause of action expires. And the defendant could prefer the counterclaim even after filing the original patent statement. The only limitation is that the claim on the date of it was not barred by limitation. And also, 2020-2 SEC 394. Now I think we can go to section destroy does not destroy the right, I said last time. Yes, now we go to section 4. What is section 4? Section 4 says expiry the period, prescribed period, when the court is closed. See the expression prescribed period. Expiry of prescribed period when court is closed. When the prescribed period for any suit, appeal, or application expires on a day when the court is closed. The suit, appeal, or application may be instituted, preferred, or made on the day on which the court reopens. Explanation: a court shall be deemed to be closed on any day within the meaning of this section if during any part of its normal working hours it remains closed on the day, on that day. This section is based on the principle expression, on the maxim. Lex, L-E-X, non cogit, C-O-G-I-T, ad impossibilia. That is, the law does not compel a man to do that which he cannot possibly perform. Law does not compel a man to do that which he cannot possibly perform. Another maxim, actus curiae, neminem gravabit, that is quite familiar to all of us. An act of court shall not prejudice any party. Court is closed. So today is the last day of limitation for filing the suit by me. I got limitation till today. I can wait till today. Nobody will question me. Today the court is closed. Either because a local holiday was declared by the collector or by the government. It was a working day, but a local holiday was declared because of certain circumstances, some dignitary passed away or something like that. Therefore, I could not file it. Next day is Saturday and Sunday, non-working days. Then Monday, I can file it on Monday. And the suit is not barred because the court is closed. Even a part of the working day, suppose after lunch, the court is closed, then it can be. Suppose a suit can be filed either in court X or in court Y. There are certain such cases where the suit for partition, several properties are there. One item of property is in one district and another item of property is within the jurisdiction of another court in the same district or another district. So the suit can be filed either here, X court or Y court. X court, a holiday was declared, local holiday was declared. And therefore, X court remains closed on that day. But Y court was functioning. But I file it on X court itself on the next day. Then the other side raises a contention. You could have filed it in Y court. Y court was functioning. Then why you did not file it in Y court and therefore your suit in X court is barred? No. It is my prerogative. Question is whether the court having jurisdiction is closed or not. X court has jurisdiction. Y court has also jurisdiction. It is my preference, plaintiff's preference. So I prefer X court. It's a holiday. Then, but X court is a holiday. I cannot file it on the next day in Y court and claim the benefit, which I am not entitled to. Yes. Section 4 could apply to suits, appeals, and applications, civil or criminal. It applies to criminal cases also. It does not extend the period of limitation, but only excludes that period. And if two courts have concurrent jurisdiction to entertain the suit and one of them is closed, the plaintiff is competent to file the suit on the next reopening day. The fact that the other court to which he could have filed the suit was open on that day is not at all material in computing the period of limitation on the court where the suit was actually filed. This is a case. It is in a Kerala case, ILR 1965, 1 Kerala, 143, Subramanya Iyer versus Lakshmi Ammal. And if the plaintiff's title to the property is to be extinguished on the expiry of the period of 12 years, applying Section 27 of the Limitation Act, and that date happens to be a Sunday, period of 12 years expires, adverse possession sets in, and the period provided in Article 65 of the Limitation Act is over. Section 27 says that the right itself will get extinguished. That right got extinguished on Sunday. It's a holiday. Suit is filed on the next day. The contention by the defendant is that the right is extinguished under Section 27. It is no matter whether the court is closed. No matter whether it is prescribed period ends, no matter whether that exclusion is possible or not, it is not. Section 4 applies. And if the period of 12 years expires on a Sunday or a holiday, then on the next day it can be filed. Section 4 applies. Then there is a case which is reported in it is a Kerala decision that is relying on a Bombay decision. That may be helpful to you. I may say that. Another Supreme Court judgment, 2010-5 SCC 459. Supreme Court, two judges, Oriental Aroma Chemical Industries Limited versus Gujarat Industrial Development Corporation. Oriental Aroma Chemicals Industries Limited versus Gujarat Industrial Development Corporation and another. Law of limitation is founded on public policy, etc. Paragraph 8, sufficient cause. I'm sorry, I committed a mistake. That is in Section 3. Section 4, AER 2016 Supreme Court 3284 Ajay Gupta versus Raju alias Rajendra Singh Yadav by Justice Rohingtan Nariman and Justice Kurian Joseph. Detailed discussion paragraph 3, 4, and 6. If section 4 applies, court is closed. It can be extended, but not otherwise. A beautiful discussion is there in paragraph 3, 4, 5, and 6. 7 also. Whereas 7 also. Then Justice Faiz Kuriakose of Kerala High Court. It is reported in 2005 KHC, Kerala High Court cases 70, 70. Kerala Law Times also it is reported 2005 1 KLT 434. What is that case? And also along with that, please also note AER 1979 Bombay 14. That Bombay decision was followed by the Kerala High Court. What is this? A property was sold in court auction. The 25% of the amount should be deposited then and there. The balance should be deposited within 15 days. If it is not there, the sale will go. On the date on which that deposit is to be made, there was a strike by the employees of the government, NGOs, non-gazetted officers, throughout the state of Kerala. And it went on for more than 30 days. No deposit could be made. And therefore, the sale could not be confirmed. Deposit was made on the next day when the strike was recalled. Next day. And it was contended that the deposit was within time. It was opposed. And it was argued before the High Court that the employees were on strike does not mean that the court was closed. It is true that the working of the court was paralyzed, but does not mean that the court is closed. And therefore, Section 4 cannot be applied. That was the argument. That argument was repelled, relying on the Bombay decision, which I referred to, exactly on the point that when there was a strike, it is practically impossible for making the deposit. This is what is held. I adopt the reasoning of the Bombay High Court in Rama. That is what is said. The court noticed that the sale was conducted on a day immediately preceding the commencement of the strike. And the strike was over on such and such date, which was succeeded by so and so a second Saturday and Sunday, etc. And therefore, it was held that the deposit made on the next day after recalling the strike was good, and the deposit was made within time, and the sale was liable to be confirmed. Bombay Court. Then another decision of the Supreme Court, AER 1996 Supreme Court 796. This is a very important case. Please see discussion paragraph 14, 15, the paragraph 13, 14, and 15. Manohar Joshi versus Nitin Barua Patil. That is Manohar Joshi, who was the Chief Minister of Maharashtra. Election case. Question was whether the Representation of People Act is an exhaustive code and whether Limitation Act applies. It was held that it is an exhaustive code. But what about Section 10 of the General Clause Act? And General Clause Act was applied. The period of limitation provided under the Representation of People Act expired on a day which is a holiday. Court is closed. So the election petition was filed on the next day. Question was whether within the period of limitation. The Supreme Court applied Section 10 of the General Clause Act and held that the election petition was within time. See the detailed discussion in paragraph 13, 14, and 15. Then another decision, AER 1973, Supreme Court 313. Decision by judgment by Justice K.K. Matthew, three judges. Very strict view was taken by the Supreme Court. A suit was filed before a particular court. Then it was transferred to another court. Then that court returned the plaint that a railway with respect to a railway incident. damages was claimed. Then it was held that no, this court has no jurisdiction. Jurisdiction lies in some other court. Then it was filed in that court. And the time spent before the two courts was thought to be excluded by saying that Section 4 should be applied. Supreme Court said Section 4 does not apply. Section 4 does not apply. You chose a court which is not having jurisdiction. Territory, of course. And Section 4 does not apply to that. Section 14 may apply. And if that appeal was heard by the Supreme Court today, suo motu, the Supreme Court would have applied Section 14 and condoned the delay. But at that time, that was in 1973, court was so strict and it was held that Section 4 does not apply and it was dismissed. And it was held that the suit is barred by limitation. If it is now, 2021, Supreme Court would have allowed it. Not under Section 4, but under Section 14. Yes, please read that judgment. Paragraph. Detailed discussion. Very detailed. I will refer to the paragraphs. Paragraph 4, 5, 8. With that, I think I have to some extent covered the requirement of this webinar and exactly 1 hour. Yes, thank you very much.
And we'll meet
next time with another section. Next time we may take sections 5, 6, 7 and 8 together, 9 and 10. All these things can be covered.
We can. Some people had asked that we should take a session on continuous wrong and what is a one-time cause of action. We will discuss it after the webinar.
Yes, yes.
Because next session would be on civil procedure code. Because we are alternatively taking it.
CPC, which topic?
So we will take it. We will see as to what questions are coming. And thank you to all those friends who have been posting the judgments which Justice Katie Santamon was referring during his webinars. I will just look because of the group, we don't have any question as to whether we have on the Facebook. You explained in a lucid manner that people don't just post much questions. Yes, there's one. Sir, if any cause of action hasn't occurred and has been continuously, for example, in money recovery suit, etc., can Section 113 be applicable here for filing recovery suits?
I did not understand the question.
He says, sir, if any cause of action doesn't occur and has been continuing, for example, in a money recovery suit, can Section 113? I have also not been able to understand.
113 of which section? Which act?
It is again silent.
113 article. Any suit for which no period of limitation is prescribed, it is 3 years when the right to sue accrues. So that question, there is something wrong with that.
It should be Article 113 only. This is when the veto jurisdiction issue, if not raised before the first court, can't be allowed to be raised afterwards. But you said limitations can be raised in an appeal.
Yes. Provided it is clear from the admitted or proved facts or on the face of the plate. And it is a question of law. Then even if it is not raised, it can be raised in appeal and, as Supreme Court held, successive appeals.
This is how to calculate the limitation in the partition suit when the plaintiff has sold the property to his elder brother and now raised the fraud after a period of 33 years.
Now the only question is whether there is any adverse possession. Otherwise not. That is the principle of adverse possession is that Article 65, which we will deal with very elaborately. Article 64 and 65 are the most important article when we come to the practical situations. Almost every suit on the civil side, either this contention of adverse possession and limitation is being raised or some other contention barring, except that the other articles not constantly applicable, but in almost at least 25% of the suits, this Article 64 and 65 may apply. Therefore, we will concentrate on that. But immediately, I may say, Article 65, which provides for a title suit, the period of limitation is 12 years, and it starts from the date when the possession of the defendant becomes adverse. That is quite different from the Limitation Act before 1963, 1908 Act. There, it was the plaintiff was bound in every suit to prove that he was possessed within 12 years. So the burden of proof was on the plaintiff to prove that his possession, he continued in possession within 12 years. But now, after the 1963 Act, the burden of proof is on the defendant to prove that when his adverse possession commenced. And if 12 years expired, adverse possession sets in, and then Section 27 also will apply.
Question has been posted by Shobha, but we will not take because it's not on the Limitation Act. But Rohit says, what about an appeal in a tribunal where relevant law provides that the Limitation Act is applicable, wherein online appeal as well as physical appeals are allowed, and on the last date the court is closed, and on the next working day, online appeal is filed, whether continuation under Section 4 would be given or not?
Yes. It will be given. It is not exactly condonation, but it is exclusion. And the petition filed on the next day is good because the special statute says that Limitation Act is applicable. Limitation Act would apply even if it is not set in the special statute, provided it is a court. If it is a tribunal or quasi-judicial authority, there must be some indication in the special statute that the Limitation Act will apply. So here, from the question, it is clear that the special statute provides that the Limitation Act will apply, in which case Section 4 also will apply. And it is filed on the last day is on a date which is court is closed, filed on the next day, whether online or directly, it is well within time.
Is limitation a mixed question of law, in fact?
It is a question of law. It is a mixed question of law, in fact. It is a pure question of law and pure question of fact also. Sometimes depends. If it is a mixed question of law and fact, it cannot be raised as a preliminary ground. Order 14 Rule 2 CPC says, which are all cases where it can be raised as a preliminary issue. There, it says that there are two clauses A and B, which says that if it is a pure question of law, it affects the jurisdiction of the court. These parameters are satisfied, can be decided as a preliminary issue. So if a question of limitation, if it is a pure question of law, it can be raised as a preliminary issue and it can be decided. On the other hand, if it is a mixed question of law and fact, then it is a matter to be tried.
Devdas, can a decree be executed through another relief of declaration in a counterclaim where decree was barred by limitation?
I did not get the question.
I also feel it's not very happily worded. It says, can a decree be executed through another relief of declaration in a counterclaim where decree was barred by limitation?
I do not understand the question.
That's what I'm saying. Ultimately, the decree, whatever decree flows, that only can be given.
Executed.
And that's not the law.
Not by a suit for declaration.
Even otherwise, the law is right or wrong, whatever the judgment is.
Yes.
It has to be binding in at least intercede the parties.
True.
That is way back from 67 Supreme Court, yes. State of Bihar versus Sonabai. Yeah. So, thank you, sir, for giving an enlightening session. We will tie up for the next session. And to all the friends who have been watching us live, we are thankful that you have been encouraging us. But one of the intentions of this webinars are that we should keep on learning the knowledge. And it is another mode that we continue to remain at home. And that is the best way of safety. So the knowledge is on the virtual platform is acting as a safety wall for all persons who are watching us and to the entire family, because jaan hai to jaan hai. And again, we would say that those who want to watch the previous webinars, they should like, subscribe and comment upon the videos of the YouTube channel of Justice K.T. Sankaran as well as Beyond Law CLC. We are enamored by the fact that you are encouraging us. at tomorrow we will take a session on offer and acceptance on Indian Contract Act by a well-known lawyer of Karnataka, that is by C.K. Nandkumar. So tomorrow join us at 6:30 p.m. Everyone stay safe, stay blessed, and thank you, sir, once again. Your health and prosperity is paramount and surmountable for all of us. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Sure. So shall I leave?